very grateful. I've given in, but by your power, I still win. There are people running scared of what they see, trying to find the way out of misery. Rumors of war. But I know you got it all in the palm of your hand. You're worthy to be praised. Lord, I'm so grateful.
Lord, I'm so grateful
for
to be praised.
Yes, you are.
read in the paper the other day about a preacher who fell from grace. He begged the church for forgiveness. He realized he made a mistake. And some folks left the church and said, "You're supposed to be a man of the cloth." See, they forgot he was the same man that prayed for them when they were lost. So glad God is not like man. He won't throw you away after you've done wrong, but I'll pick you up and dust you off and put you back where you belong. God didn't give up on me. I'm so glad.
God,
yeah,
didn't give up on me.
When I gave up, now it's easy to point the finger when the spotlight's not on you. Well, and we would be surprised what we'd see if the truth come out on you. And you need to show a little mercy and grace for somebody else. Oh, and take your foot off your brother and consider yourself. I'm glad God is not like man. When you're done wrong, he will pick you up, put you back where you belong. Oh, no, yeah. You'll never, never let me fall. When I need you, I can call.
Good evening. Let us worship and let us pray. Lord, I want to pray for the boys in rites of passage. The boys, please help them. This Easter Sunday, when this program, thank you. I would like to bless Pastor Whalen and Miss First Lady Sheila. Bless everyone to come to church. Thanks for blessing me and keeping me in prayer. Lord, I love you. Amen. And amen.
Amen. It is so. All right. Hold on to this.
Lord, we worship you in spirit.
Hallelujah, God. Glory, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God. Thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah, Lord Jehovah God. Thank you, Lord God. Glory to your mighty name, Lord God. You are creator of heaven and all, Father God. You are the master of the universe, O Lord. We lift up your mighty name right now, Father God, this day and forevermore, Father God. Hallelujah, Lord God. Without you, holy and mighty God, we are nothing, Lord God. We are nothing but dust, O Lord. Thank you, God. I come to you first with a repentant heart, Father God. Lord, I thank you for your loving kindness and your mercy for me, Father God. And please, Father God, we come right now, please, asking your forgiveness, Father God. Give it for our trespasses unto you, Lord God, and you alone, Lord God. We thank you, Father God, for here right now, Lord God. We thank you for those who are on their way, Lord God. I thank you for those who hear my lips right now, Lord God, and hear my voice right now, this prayer, Father, Lord. We lay here before you at this altar in true worship, O Lord, and interceding in prayer as a church, Father God. Bless our faithfulness, O Lord. O Lord Jesus, as we assemble together once again, Lord God, to hear and study your word, Father God. Please bless us, Father God, with a reward that we cannot fathom, Father. We lift up our pastor, Lord God, the father of this house, O Lord, who will soon preach this word as it was written and intended for your children, O Lord. We thank you, Father God, Heavenly Father. We thank you, Jesus, for our pastor of meticulous preparation and devotion to his assignment, Lord God. So we praise your name, Lord God. Hallelujah, Lord, for the anointing on this house, Lord God, that we all have benefited from over the years, O Lord. Thank you, Lord God, for all of love, Lord. Thank you, Lord God, for loving us through our destiny, even if we fail, Lord God. I thank you for that spirit that abounds this church house, Lord God. No matter where we are, Lord God, I thank you for the constant protection and ever watchful care of my family, Lord God, and my sons, oh Lord. Lord God, you are so good, Lord. You are so good, Father God. All the time, Lord God. I can't thank you enough also for a church where I can observe and hone my spousal commitments and my fatherhood skills, Lord God, as well as offer mentorship to others, oh Lord. I praise your name, Lord God, thanking you for the opportunity, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for showing one how to do so, Lord God. I thank you for the mentors galore at this church, Lord God. Jesus, please bless our own brotherhood of mentorship, Lord God. Please bless our own fraternity of believers, Father God. With a legacy of being a light in this city, Lord God, we are here, Lord God. Please bless our mission, Lord God, to instill the principles of pride, of valor, of knowledge, Lord God, and truth into our youth, Jesus. As the four pillars, Lord God, and principles of and disciplines of the rites of passage, Lord God. Pride, Lord God, being a really tricky concept, Lord God, but we want to know that we want to lead by example in a God kind of life, Lord God, knowing that the life they live is pleasing unto you, Lord God, and you alone, Father God. That's the pride, Lord God, that we're looking for, Lord God, not being led astray with our own misunderstandings, Lord God, our own doings, Father God, and of valor, Father God, a life of valor, boldness, and bravery, Lord God, a quality of mind that to face any hardships as Christ did for us in love, Lord God, as he did, Lord. And knowledge, Father God, where our mentors, Lord God, will pour into our arrows and encourage our arrows to never shy away from it, Lord God. Never shy away from knowledge and to always ask questions, Lord God, because I know, Lord God, that a loaded weapon is even more dangerous than a loaded mind is even more dangerous than a loaded weapon, Lord God. And truth, Father God, knowing the difference between the multitudes of falsehoods in this world, Lord God, and the corruption, Lord God, and that seeking answers, Lord God, will ultimately mean seeking you and your word, Father. We thank you, Lord God. We thank you for rites of passage, Lord God, and the mission, Father God, of this man's month, Lord God. We thank you, Father God, for what's about to undo, Lord God, and unfold, Father God, this Sunday, Lord God. Let it be a powerful message, Father God, for our boys, Lord God. Please bless our minds, our bodies, Lord God. Please bless our spirits as men, Lord God, of this house, Lord God, to know that this objective cannot be completed overnight, Lord. So that we ask that you bless the men of this house with supernatural discipline, Lord God, supernatural commitment, Father God, and long suffering for the generation of arrows, Lord God, and then the ones to come, Lord God. leaving a legacy worthy of your praise, oh Father God. That's what we're looking for, Father. Father God, thank you for sending your only begotten Son, Lord. Thank you, Lord God, for preparing us, Lord God, for him, Lord God. Lord. Thank you for him, Lord God, for preparing us as well, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for the love that was signified for long, so long ago, Lord God, as we remember and honor this faithful week, oh Lord. Thank you for defeating even death, Jesus. Thank you for defeating even death, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God, for doing it for me, Jesus. Glory, hallelujah, Lord. Thank you for doing it for us, Lord Jesus. We praise your name right now, Lord God. We believe your word is true, Father. God, I pray and agree in Jesus' mighty name, Lord God, in every prayer with this house, Father God, in Jesus' name. Glory and amen.
Lord, we worship you in spirit and truth. Lord, we worship you in spirit and truth.
Lord, thank you for this worship center that's a breeding ground for success. Lord, bless the different ministries and the leaders of those ministries. Lord, even when I fail, you made me over. Even when I failed you, Lord, you've made me over. And then when I messed up again, you made me over again. Lord, my granny used to say she was knee bent, body bowed, worshiping you. That's why I honor our pastor when he says, blow kisses, lay prostrate, and kneel as you worship him. Lord, we need the rites of passage program because we're passing down wisdom. And anybody that is stand up for a child, look for them, they need to be blessed as well. Jesus Christ's name I pray, amen.
Lord, we worship you in spirit and truth. Lord, we worship you in spirit and truth.
Bless you for your loving kindness, your grace, your mercy. Thank you, God, for second chances on second chances. Thank you, God, for resurrection and renewal. Thank you, God, for planting me in a church that's the preeminent church for teaching true worship. Thank you, God, for the revelations that you pour out upon our pastor, oh God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you told him that now is the time to resurrect relationships. Now is the time. Thank you, Lord, for giving our pastor the revelation that now is the time for men to be men and to engage our boys. Yes, God. Father God, you gave it to Hosea to say that people perish because of a lack of knowledge, and mentorship is about passing on wisdom and passing on knowledge, and And we thank you for that, Lord. We thank you. We thank you for that opportunity. Bless you, God. God, we pray for strength. I pray for me and every man in this church to be the kind of man who can transmit to boys what you would have them know. Father God, since humanity began, men have passed on what knowledge they've had of how to do forever. And families became tribes and nations. And God, we live in a nation right now where there seems to be no real direction. Everything seems to go. We live in a nation where we've got to step up and teach our children, Lord. Give us the strength to teach our children that it's not okay for men to kiss men in the mouth. Give us the strength, Lord, to raise our boys to be the kinds of those that would you call to be husbands, to be the kind of husband men, to be a covering over their wives, the women that you give them to marry, and be a covering and protection and a provider for their children. Lord, this is the time for us to work to reinforce what we believe in, and we believe in you. And so, God, help us teach our boys of what it is to be a godly man. And we can't do it without you, because the only way we can do it, God, is if you help us do it. Help us, Lord. Help us be fit for the fight. Help us teach them that pride is not a negative thing. That because we are made in your image and likeness, that we have much to be proud of. Help us teach them that pride involves a person carrying themselves with dignity. To carry themselves worthy of honor and respect. Help us, God. Help us, God, walk before them in such a way that they would want to model us to be dignified men and men who are unbending in principle. Help us, Lord. Please, Lord, please. We cannot do it without, hear my prayer, God. We cannot do this without you. Help us pass on this knowledge, if first and foremost, that fear of you, oh God, respect for who you are, Lord, is the beginning of knowledge. And help us walk in that in such a way that they value the education that they receive in church. Help them understand that knowledge will begin. Help us all know that our knowledge begins in the study of your word, because every answer to every question is there. Help us, Lord. Help us, give us your spirit, oh God, that will guide us in discerning the truth from a lie. Help us, God. Help us, Lord. We need you, God. We need you, God. God, help us. Give our arrows a trajectory of success in the kingdom. Help them receive the discipline. Help them deal with the pain of bending their will to yours. Help us, Lord. Help us, Lord. Reveal your word and let us walk in it. Let us let us give it to our children, O God. Please, Lord. There are so many things. This is the right time. This is the right time for rites of passage. Rites of passage. Help us be men of valor, O God. Help us be men of valor before our children, and help us teach our children, our sons, how to be courageous and to be fearless in a world where bullying and guns and threats and gangs and craziness of all kind. Help us mold them to be men of valor so that they will have the valor to walk away when somebody passes the joint. Help us give them what they need to know in order to be men. They will not be men unless we teach them. Lord, help us give to them what you give to us, because we can't be men without you. Bless you, God. Bless you, God. Lord, I pray for every person that participates in ROP. I pray for our guys who are preparing themselves to lead us in worship. And what better day than Easter Sunday? Who does that? Who does that? Thank you for the pastor that we have. That looks at what's relevant and what's needed. He preaches the gospel every Sunday. He preaches a gospel of a resurrected Christ Jesus. And so, yes, he can use Easter Sunday to resurrect spirits in men, to resurrect spirits in women, to give them encouragement that there's help on the way. Thank you, God. Bless you, God. Bless you, God. Yeah. Bless our boys. The world's not the world that it was. It's not the world that I grew up in.
Yes, God.
And in my younger years, and Bill, it's not the world. So pray with us in this world that's so different, that we would listen to our boys so that we know exactly what they need and need to pray with them.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
To give them courage, to give them strength.
Yes, Lord.
To teach them dignity.
Yes, Lord.
And to teach them the truth.
Yes, Lord.
Your truth. Your truth.
Yes, Lord.
Your values, God.
Yes, Lord.
Your values. Your values. Of being honest, of having integrity, of treating people right.
My God.
Of forgiving those who offend you. It help us, help them understand that you have to forgive even people you have trouble loving.
Yes, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord.
Because there's trouble out here for them.
Yes, Lord.
Help us, Lord.
Help us, Lord.
Be the men, the mentors that you would have us be.
Yes, Lord.
Pour your spirit. Continue to pour your spirit into it.
Yes,
upon
God.
Upon our pastor. Continue to give him the leadership that he gives to take us where we need to be.
Yes, Lord.
Even if we don't want to go. Help us teach our sons. And they're all our sons.
Yes, Lord.
Help us teach them that valor is going where you don't want to go, but you go because you must go, because that's what God has called you to do.
Yes, Lord.
To trust him.
Yes, Lord.
That even in the most fearful times, to stand tall.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bless you, God. This I pray in Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
And in thanksgiving, oh God.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. It's a good place to say amen.
Lord, we were.
You can let it play. As we all stand, hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Lord, we worship you.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
In
thank you, Lord. Come on, let's stir up the atmosphere. Stir up the atmosphere with a yes and an amen. Yes. 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 Yes and amen. Yes. 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 And amen. 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 Yes. Come on, yes. And amen. Yes.
Spirit.
Hallelujah. Yes, 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 yes. We hear a lot of no's these days. It's nice to hear yes, amen, yes, yes. We hear a lot of not yet. It's nice to articulate a yes. The man of God said that the time is right. For rites of passage, amen. Hallelujah. Yes and amen to every prayer that was prayed. From Anthony to Willie, amen. Amen. Come on and give God glory. For those of you who were not here, Anthony was our first intercessor. Amen. And the reason is because Anthony came to me last week and said, I want to pray. He actually said, it was Saturday, he actually said, I want to do the reading of the word. So he and I stepped outside and said, come here, Anthony, let's see what you got. And so Anthony, you know, he was reading the scripture for me, and I said, well, no, let's not do this. Let's let you pray. And he had a will. We got some black folk with 4 and 5 degrees and don't have the will to pray, don't have the will to do nothing for God. And here's a young man who's challenged, but he has the, oh, look at your neighbor and ask him, where is your want to? Ask him, where is your want to? And I believe God is going to reward Anthony for his. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's my job tonight to bring to the microphone Sarah's husband. Ladies and gentlemen, Sarah's husband. Y'all put those hands together. Put those hands together for Sarah's husband.
Good evening. My faith comes from hearing myself read these words. Tonight's reading comes from Ephesians chapter 3. Verses 7 through 11, the New International Version. I became a servant of the gospel by the gift of God's grace given me through the working of his power.
Although I am less than the least of all the Lord's people, this grace was given me to preach to the Gentiles the boundless riches of Christ.
And to make plain to everyone the administration of this mystery, which for ages past was kept hidden in God, who created all things.
His intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms.
Altogether.
According to his eternal purpose that he accomplished in Christ Jesus, our Lord.
Please keep standing as we make our positive confession.
Give it up, y'all, for Reverend Kenneth Cummings, Sarah's husband. Give it up for Kenneth Cummings, ladies and gentlemen. Phi Beta Sigma. Oh, come on, give it up for Kenneth Cummings, KC. Amen. If you didn't get an outline as you came in, please get one from the table at the entrance. Grab your weapon. Those of you who are watching by way of Facebook or YouTube, please join us in this exercise every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, every Wednesday night. You would be surprised at what your own positive confession will create in your own life. Amen. All right, grab your weapon. Hold it tightly. Lift it up high. Repeat after me. This is my Bible. It is the sword of the Spirit. It is the word of God. I believe. See, it's already doing it. Y'all feel that? Y'all feel that? I believe what it says. I am what it says I am. I must do what it says I must do. I can do what it says I can do. I can have what it says I can have. After this study session, my life will never, never ever be the same. I believe it. I receive it. And I will use my sword to achieve it. In the name of Jesus, the Christ, amen, amen, and amen. Amen. Take that sword. Carve your initials in the atmosphere. It's just an act of faith. That's all it is. Just an act of faith. That's all. Now, come on, parry, which means balance. Parry, thrust, and say, now, Satan, the Lord rebuke you. Amen. Please stay on your feet, ladies and gentlemen, and help me to recite these outline subdivisions. Number one, if Congress outlawed the gospel and all manifestations of it, how would you know if you missed it or not? Number two, if it had been up to other people, I would never have received this grace. And number three, attention Christians, if you believe you can succeed against the gates of hell without being an active member of somebody's local church, you have been deceived. Signed, Jesus Christ. Again, if Congress outlawed the gospel and all manifestations of it, how would you know if you missed it or not? Number two, if it had been up to other people, I would never have received this grace. And number three, attention Christians, if you believe you can succeed against the gates of hell without being an active member of somebody's local church, you have been deceived. Signed, Jesus Christ. And once more for the Holy Spirit, if Congress outlawed the gospel and all manifestations of it, how would you know if you missed it or not? If it had been up to other people, I would never have received this grace. And finally, attention Christians, if you believe you can succeed against the gates of hell without being an active member of somebody's local church, you have been deceived. signed Jesus Christ. You may be seated. Thank you. Please receive this musical interlude in the spirit in which I have chosen it. Again, I told the rites of passage this a couple of weeks ago. For some reason, during this phase of my life, I'm into gospel rap. I don't know why that is. I'm 67 years old. I wrote a book called Hip Hop Is Not Our Enemy about 10 years ago, maybe longer than that. And now here I am at 67, really getting into gospel rap. So forgive me, but I don't know why. So I hope that this particular, and this is a very recent, this was just released in February, and it's D1. D1 is one of my favorites. One of the reasons that I like D1 is because you can hear what he's saying. You can distinguish the words that he's rapping, and I like that. Okay, D1.
Check, check, mic check, 1, 2, yeah, check it out, I came to Harvard University not knowing I would walk outside of Smith Campus Center as I'm going to my residence. Then I see a brother playing chess in this beautiful outside today, so I pull up a chair and just start to observe as he defeats all the opponents he meets. Then he asks me what I like to play, but only for a fee. I agree, plus I like to D-O-C-U-M-E-N-T, all of my experiences, so I-R-E-C-O-R-D. As we begin to play, I noticed that he was homeless and my heart began to break. I did not want to pontificate, so I did not ask any questions. He inquired about what I did. I said I rap. Now we stepped in brand new territory. Hip-hop was the icebreaker. Turns out he used to rap. He goes by Dr. Fresh. He made a bunch of songs in the 80s. He was popular, but he lost his lyrics in the dice game. It shocked me, bruh. People blew up off his songs. He told me the stories. We kept vibing, and then he started to spit for me.
Caffrey was making names, he was smelling it. But that good intelligence, couldn't see the elements. So through that stick, that fella needed felling it. Cause stitches around here, they be losing their life. They torture them sometimes like they was crucifying Christ. Bodies found in the basement.
Sometimes you gon' need to be the speaker. Other times you gon' need to listen to your teacher. Everybody has a story, you just gotta listen. Understand where they coming from and pay attention. Sometimes you gon' need to be the speaker. Other times you gon' need to listen to your teacher. Everybody has a story, you just gotta listen. Understand where they coming from and pay attention. I start to see Dr. Fresh on a daily basis, and he tells everybody, look, that's D1, y'all, he's famous. We really growing as friends, God-fearing black men. But it troubles me that he's homeless, I cannot pretend. Sometimes I buy him dinner, other times I give cash. I don't talk much, I listen to his stories from the past. We share a bunch of laughs, but as the days pass, I ask God, what's the real reason we have crossed paths? Please grant me the serenity to accept what I cannot change, and the courage to change what I can, plus the wisdom to know the difference. Some days I'm so conflicted, I chose a misfit that's bold and gifted. My soul is lifted to a higher frequency. Kindred spirits, they speak to me. Dr. Fresh is blessed to not be stressed with what people need to validate them. Chess and hip-hop, his passion stay inside of his world. Long as he got them, he is not complaining. Sometimes you gon' need to be a speaker. Other times you gon' need to listen to your teacher. Everybody has a story, you just gotta listen. Understand where they coming from and pay attention. Sometimes you gon' need to be the speaker. Other times you gon' need to listen to your teacher. Everybody has a story, you just gotta listen. Understand where they coming from and pay attention.
Bro, how do you explain something like that, bro?
Faith.
That's faith.
Yeah, that's the Lord.
That's the Lord, bro. We connected for a reason, bro.
That's the Lord, y'all.
We connected for, we just had a good dinner, you know, we got to catch up. Man, it's great to see you, brother. You're looking good, brother.
Well, I mean, it is what it is. Amen. Amen. Amen.
My bad. I let that dude.
Hi, my name is Kenneth, and I'm a worshipaholic. The last words that D1 said on the video were, I love that dude. I love that dude. Go to the next image. There is nothing more beautiful nor more empowering than the notion of black men loving one another. I don't mean in a prurient kind of way. Look that up. I don't mean in a obscene or inappropriate kind of way. The Bible puts it this way. It says, behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. There is nothing more beautiful nor more empowering than the notion of black men standing together in unity, in love toward each other. One of the things that drew me to Morehouse College was not the fact that my uncle was the chairman of the music department. It was not the fact that my other uncle graduated from Morehouse, nor was it the fact that Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was an alumnus. What really drew me to Morehouse was when I was about 12 years old, I went to Lemoyne College. Anybody ever heard of Lemoyne? It's now Lemoyne Owen, L-O-C. And in the gymnasium at Lemoyne, the Morehouse College Glee Club was in concert. And as the audience sat waiting for the concert to begin, you couldn't see any of the Glee Club. In fact, the choir stand was empty. Everything was empty. And then you heard this rumbling. And you look, and there are 44 young black men moving with dispatch and purpose and no nonsense. And in a matter of seconds, they were from invisible to completely front and center, singing together in harmony. That is what drew me. The sight, the sound, the synergy. That's three S words. Of black men standing together in unity. No matter how difficult, I'll start teaching in a minute. No matter how difficult or seemingly intractable the problems of our current age might appear, among our people, there is absolutely no doubt in my mind that the solution lies in black men standing together in love and unity. And you can love another man and still be a man. So that's why I chose that particular image for Bring a Brother Night. Go to the next one. Secondly, I find it exhilarating that God gave me the idea of lifting and highlighting the Divine Nine, the fraternities and the Divine Nine, just as we did for the sororities in October. There's something very, very powerful about that. The shields, the seals, the symbolism. The problem is, may I talk frankly? May I be frank? Even though my name is Kenneth? The problem is that the people who need to witness it are usually not here. That's a problem. Now, there is nothing negative about acknowledging a problem. Acknowledging problems is not a sign of weakness. I need one or two witnesses. In fact, not acknowledging problems is a sign of stupidity. Sheer, substantive stupidity, since I'm dealing with S words. So that's a problem. It's a problem that the chef has prepared a balanced meal. A nutritious blend, and the people who need to eat it are somewhere eating Cheez-Its and Doritos, and y'all not gonna help me. But that's not a problem that has no solution. The solution is that those of us who are here have a greater responsibility now to take what we have received and disseminate it in whatever fashion to those who need it. That is the solution. Now, before I begin teaching per se, look at your neighbor and ask him. No, don't ask him nothing. Tell him this. Tell him, it's on you now. Look at another neighbor and tell him, it's on you now. All right. That's it. Since this is the last Bring a Brother Night, curbs during Mizma. All right. Let's read verse 7 again. I became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace given me through the working of his power. On the outline, I say, the question on the outline is, if Congress outlawed the gospel and all manifestations of it, how would you know if you missed it or not? Let me clarify. If Congress passed a law, and y'all, I wouldn't be surprised at anything. Can I get a witness? I wouldn't be surprised at nothing that this Congress did. Nothing. And while I don't want to, Diane, help me now, because I feel myself going off on a tangent now. Listen. I'm not one of those people who believe that all Democrats are right and all Republicans are wrong. That's not me. I'm not a person who subscribes to the theory that you got to be liberal or conservative. I don't believe that. I don't believe that all white folk are bad. I ain't gonna get no help in here. And all black folk are good. I don't even believe that. You know how I don't believe it? From personal experience. Matter of fact, ain't no white folk never broke in my house. Okay, thank you, Diane. Thank you. I'm back on track. Thank you. So this, my point with this is, so if Congress outlawed the gospel and outlawed every manifestation of the gospel, and we had to stop doing everything that's related to the gospel, how would you know you missed it? Would you even miss it? And y'all would, but I'm saying, a whole lot of folk that belong to a whole lot of churches, or at least got their name on the roll, or at least been baptized at one time or another, wouldn't even miss it. You know how I know they wouldn't, because they don't do it now. Negroes don't go to church, man. If they outlaw the gospel and all the manifestation of the gospel, church is a manifestation of the gospel. Studying the word of God. Negroes don't study the word of God, no way. They wouldn't know that there was a law against it. So-called church folk don't study the Bible. Okay, you guess what? Let me go on right now. Let me give y'all permission not to say nan, amen. Because I'm telling the T-R-U-T-H, and the truth is whether you say amen or not. So that's the overall question. If Congress passed a law outlawing the gospel and all manifestations of it, how would you know? How would you know you missed it? On the outline, I say, first of all, what is the gospel? That's a very good question. Hint, hint. What does that say? See what? John 3:16. That's the gospel in a nutshell. For all y'all know it. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life, and that the world through him might be saved. That's the gospel in a nutshell. Y'all, listen, you might not have a master's in theology, but you ought to at least be able to tell somebody what the gospel is. You know what our problem is? We lazy. Okay, I'm gonna raise my hand. Lazy means you know what you ought to do, but you just don't feel like doing it. Okay, I'm just telling on me. I know y'all ain't. Everybody in here today, everybody in here who has had anything to do with any other human being has had an opportunity to share the gospel. If there's no more time than reciting the verse, for God so loved the world. So in that one verse is every element of the gospel story. Love, gave, the world, his only begotten. Now, so what is that in the upper right quadrant of the screen? Can you tell what that is? A nail. And so therein lies the instrument of the giving. He gave his only begotten son. How? By allowing him to die. He didn't commit suicide. He was nailed to a cross, hung there all night, Friday night. Stayed there all day Saturday and all night Saturday night. But you got to say that with a tune. But early Sunday morning, he, therein lies the gospel. He gave his only begotten son that whosoever believeth. What you got to believe? You got to believe what I just said. Jesus is God's only son. God gave him through a virgin birth, allowed him to live 33 years, died on the cross, was buried in a borrowed tomb. And on the, he with, and don't be redundant. Don't say with all power in his hand, because if Negro get up from the dead, we can assume that he got all power in his hand. Get up from the dead, you got power in your eyelash. Your natural eyelash. It wasn't that funny, Tina. It wasn't that funny. Yes, it was. Yes, it was. That's the essence of the gospel. And you know it. Over the last 4 minutes, I ain't said nothing you didn't know. I ain't giving you no revelation that you didn't already know. Don't die with it in you. All right, so that's the gospel. And the question is, if Congress outlawed the gospel and all manifestations of it, how would you know? Missed it. Next on the outline. And we still in verse 7. Some countries have outlawed it. I said, some countries have outlawed the gospel. Ain't you glad you don't live in a country that has outlawed the gospel yet? You say, well, Congress would never outlaw the gospel. Y'all, 40 years ago, 30 years ago, 10 years ago, you wouldn't have thought that Congress would pass a law that legalized same-sex union. Let me come down here. Because it's not called marriage. They can't call it marriage. Come on, the ones getting married, the ones hooking up are calling it marriage.
You better teach.
If marriage is so bad, how come everybody trying it? The law says same-sex union, civil union. That's legal. Who would have thought that Congress would pass a bill legalizing that, and that the bill was pushed through by... Who am I imitating? Yes, it's uncomfortably quiet in here. Who would have thought? Who would have ever thought that there would be a legal concept such as trans anything? Well, the law will protect you, and the law says as long as you think you're a woman, The law will recognize you as a woman. Even though all of us can see your equipment. Who would have ever thought that the law of the land would allow a woman to say, call me mister. I hope you don't think that I'm being disrespectful. I'm just observing what the truth is. Look it up. Look up trans anything. It's a state of, it's not a state of biology. Stop it. Stop. Now, a reasonable person, a saved trans person, ain't mad at me for that. Because they know I'm telling the truth. Who would have ever thought? So don't sit up and act like, oh, they would never outlaw the God. Oh, they would never outlaw going to church. Oh, stop it. They outlawed it during COVID. Go to the next one. I don't think it's ever been this quiet in Bible study. And it's been quiet. We've had some quiet nights now. And when I start lying, y'all start leaving. This is from Christianity Today, and this is yesterday. This ain't 10 years ago. Yesterday, how the gaucho, the name of the article is, how the gaucho stole Easter in Uruguay. More than 100 years ago, Latin America's most secular country abolished Christian holidays. Local church leaders have struggled to reclaim them since. This week, millions of Latin Americans are attending worship services observing Palm Sunday, Maundy Thursday, which is tomorrow, Good Friday, and Easter Sunday. In Uruguay, they are going to the rodeo. While their Spanish and Portuguese-speaking neighbors mark the death and resurrection of Christ, locals from the country of 3.3 million are celebrating Semana Criolla, Creole Week, a series of festivals honoring the country's gaucho heritage. Many come to watch Uruguay's national sport, jineteada, I am probably mispronouncing that, where riders attempt to stay on the back of untamed horses. Few of the activities, which also include traditional music and dancing, acknowledge the Christianity calendar, except when it comes to eating asado criollo. So before you go to the next screen, so the nation of Uruguay outlawed all Christian holidays, including Christmas. No Christmas, no Easter, no Lenten week, no Holy Week, no nothing to do with Christianity. And in its place, they just observe a festival that celebrates gaucho heritage. You can look gaucho up. So, and the only thing they are allowed to practice that has any reference, any Christian reference at all, is a feast called Asado Criollo. Go to the next image. What Asado Criollo is the practice of cooking either whole animals or huge slices, pieces of an animal, over an open fire on a crucifix. You see it? You see it, don't you? That's the only reference to Christianity that can be allowed legally in Uruguay. But in the United States of America, where we are free, even churches where people claim to be faithful, are more empty than full. And that's not a criticism. It is an observation. You're not blind. Take a second and look around. I'm serious. Take a second and look around. All right, now, still in verse 7. Now, my question was, if Congress outlawed Christianity and all manifestations of it, how would you know if you miss it or not? Here's my personal testimony. I would miss it. Go to the next one. I would miss it because I'm a servant. I would miss it because I'm a servant. I mean, Christianity is who I am and what I do. I would miss it. I missed it when they outlawed it during the COVID. And the only reason I didn't say, y'all, come on, let's come to church anyway, is because I didn't want y'all to die, and I ain't ready to die. And as soon as I could come, I did, even though y'all couldn't yet. So I would miss it if it were outlawed because I'm a servant. That's what I do. It's who I am. But why would you miss it? And that's not a rhetorical question. Just a couple of seconds. I'm not going to bring a mic down. But why would anybody? I need for you to shout out why you would miss it if Congress outlawed Christianity and all manifest. Yes, Tina? Because it's something I practice on the regular. Anybody else? Why would you? Yes. This is where I draw my strength. Yes. The fellowship and especially Cana, couples achieving newness again. Yes, Ron. Oh, I saw your hand. Anybody else? Yes. The assembly of the saints. Anybody else? Yes. I'm a scholar. I learn. Anybody else? How would you know you missed it? If Congress out? Yes. It's what? It's my identity. Yes. Togetherness. Anybody else? How would you know? Yes. Christianity is my foundation. Anybody else? One or two more. How would you? Yes. I wouldn't know how to worship. Okay. One more maybe? Yes. Curtis said, my week would be all jacked up without it. It would be all jacked up. Yes, Kenneth. My faith wouldn't allow you to miss it. Okay. All right. Is that it? Anybody else? Okay. All right. Next. Woo! And this is one of my favorites right here. If it had been up to other people, I would never have received this grace. Y'all know I ain't lying. If it had been up to some other folk, man, I'd be butt naked, starving and homeless. Period. And I got news for you. If it was up to other folk, you wouldn't have gotten there neither. See, y'all think that long as you don't bother nobody, everything gonna be all right. Ain't nobody gonna bother you. The devil is a lie. Can I get a witness? Ain't it, man, please. If it was up to other folk, look at the verse. Look at verse 8. Although I am less than the least of all the Lord's people, this grace was given me. In other words, I didn't deserve it. Y'all are absolutely right. Why Whalum get it? You're absolutely right. How the Lord gonna pick a failure
Why would the Lord choose somebody that failed at his chosen profession? That don't even make no sense. Look like God would find somebody who passed the bar exam on the first try, or at least on the third try, or at least on the tenth try. But the Lord done chose Balaam, who never did pass the bar. I'm with y'all. It don't make no sense. But guess what? Look at somebody and tell them, but he did. Y'all, you didn't deserve it either, but guess what? But he did. The man of God just got through praying about how he failed and God gave him another chance. And he failed again and God gave him another chance. Who would do that? I wouldn't. But he's God. I need a witness. He's God. And the thing about it is, he's God all by. He don't need. You know, God don't need no matches. Because he's fire all by himself. He's somebody. Yes. See, I'm getting ready to mess with y'all now. I dare you to think about. I dare to think about how good he been to you. All you got to do is just spend a little time. If you could get on up out of your feelings and get on up out of your little attitude, your little funky attitude about what ain't going right in your life, I dare you to just think about the last time God blew your mind. Getting you out of a situation that you had no business getting into in the. Go back to verse 7. I became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace given me through the working of his power. So the thing about it is the working of his power, and I've used this in demonstrations a lot, but I ain't found nothing else that conveys it more clearly. See, God's grace, the manifestations, the instrumentation by which he gives us grace, it's invisible to other people. You can't, Irwin, you cannot identify how it is God does what he does. Y'all tell the truth. You look at him, God done something, and you said, where did, I need one or two witnesses now, where did that? Where did that come from? Lord, you be worrying about something, and when you be worrying, you say, wait a minute. You mean it's already done? And so he uses invisible instrumentation to direct his grace. And you ain't got to catch it, but I'm just, there you go. There you go, yeah. She don't even look like she can catch, but there you go. There's something. He don't. There you go. And there's another one for your wife. I'm just saying.
It's the effectual working of his power. I got it through the working of his power. I don't need, you know what, I'm going to tell y'all the truth. Don't tell nobody I said this. I don't even need to know why and how. Okay, now, just this side, since there's fewer of y'all, can I get a witness just on this side that I really, I'm going to tell you the truth, I don't even really need to know. What I can do is tell you that it was God who did it. Everything that happened to me that was good, God did it. Oh, yes, he. All right, so I got the grace. So what's grace? So y'all trying to mess with me. Now, see, we could all be shouting. Couldn't we all be shouting if I just kept on pressing in on? Think about what he's done. Matter of fact, how come we don't spend more time thinking about what he's done? You know, I have a theory. Tammy, I have a theory. I believe there would be fewer people caught up in a web of depression if more people spent a little more time thinking and thanking. It's just a theory. I can't prove it. I can't prove it. I don't have any clinical evidence. It's just a theory. Grace. God's influence on the heart, its reflection in the life, that which affords joy, pleasure, delight, sweetness, charm, loveliness. That's a definition of grace. And I don't have to have any money, but I can still afford joy. Oh, y'all. My checking account can be in the red, and I can still afford pleasure. The bank can be about to foreclose on my home, but I can still afford delight. I might have just lost my job, but I can still afford sweetness. I might be dealing with some low-down, dirty, nasty, backstabbing, lying son of a... But I can still afford charm and loveliness because of his grace. Next. Again, verse 8. Although I am less than the least of all the Lord's people. Now, that statement is an indication of humility, isn't it? When you read that clause, don't you think, that's humility. A self-effacing statement, a statement where you put yourself down. I am the least, although I am the least of all the Lord. I'm less than the least. Oh, my God. I'm less than the least of all the Lord's people. That's humility. Look what I say on the outline. It's hard to be humble if you won't worship. Did y'all hear what I said? Let me say this. Here's an anecdote that I guess I notice it because I'm up here and I see all y'all. And if you notice that anything I'm doing on Sunday, even if it's the tithe and offering, while I'm doing it, I do this right here. Because I'm checking everybody. So here's the anecdote. I think, and I could be wrong. That's why I call it an anecdote. I could be wrong. But I think that there are Olivets who intentionally get to church late.
I could be wrong. I don't think I am. I think that there are olives who know that right at 11 o'clock, we're going to be and most of us are going to be worshiping on our faces or on our. And I think that there are people who time their entrance because they know that they won't be allowed in during worship. And here's how I know I think I'm right. Because as soon as they come in, and at no time, do they at no time quiet has reached another level. And here's another, just a little additional piece of evidence. Even if they don't arrive intentionally late, they still and we call ourselves the but if you're watching some of us, we could be called the preeminent church of avoiding. So, it's hard to be humble if you notice. Thank you. Whoever said that back there, I started to use the word don't. But there's a difference between don't and won't. And in 99.99% of the cases, a person who doesn't worship because they don't. Hard to be humble. You can't. I watch preachers and pastors at when we go to other churches or other. I watch them. And if they never worship and then try to act humble, I'm not believing you. So here's my Whalemism. If I pretend to be humble, if I say I'm humble, if I ain't lying, I'm lying. If I ain't lying, see, you get it now, right? It's a sign of a good teacher, I'm telling you. You demonstrate, you make sure people understand what you're saying. Especially if you're dealing with double entendres and you're dealing with words, you know. If I ain't lying, in other words, if I'm not lying on my face, if I'm not worshiping, if I'm not bowing, then I'm lying when I say I'm a worshiper, when I say I'm humble. Next. Verse 9, and to make plain to everyone the administration of this mystery, which for ages past was kept hidden in God who created all things. On the outline, I say, church administration is way underappreciated. Yeah, okay. People who just come in at 11:05 and leave at 1:03 don't appreciate how important administration is. This stuff don't just happen. Sheila, First Lady, wants people, I'm going to make an announcement later. I might as well make it now. Fashion show models rehearsal tomorrow night at 6 o'clock here in the sanctuary. First Lady needs helpers throughout the day tomorrow, starting at 10 o'clock. Please come by to church anytime you can spare and help arrange the seats and do what we need to do. The fashion show is Friday at 7 o'clock. And again, we need helpers also after the fashion show Friday to reset the sanctuary for the Rites of Passage program on Sunday. And people who just come to suck up the ministry don't appreciate administration. Administration is defined as, well, the King James Version calls it fellowship. It's just the operating of things, how things work together. That's why I use the gears. It's not just preaching. If my preaching doesn't interface with something else, then we have an ineffective ministry. You can't pretend to be a committed Christian if you don't ever find anything to put your hands to. Next. Still verse 9. Make plain to everyone the administration of this mystery, which for ages past was kept hidden in God who created all things. On the outline, I say, thank God the mystery isn't hidden anymore. And I use the Easter egg hunt because at most Easter egg hunts, the eggs ain't hidden. I don't know why we refer to it as a hunt. Because all the cheering got to do is look and gather. I just thank God that the mystery, in our case, worship, is not hidden anymore. Because it's been in the Word since the Word was reduced to writing. It's always been there. I'm just glad He let me find the egg. And it's a golden egg, dipped in the blood of Jesus. All of us have found the egg of worship. Finally, can I do this in 4 minutes? I think so. Attention, Christians, if you believe you can succeed against the gates of hell without being an active member of somebody's local church, you have been deceived. Look at verse 10. His intent, whose intent? His intent, whose intent? God's intent was that now, when? Now, now through what? The church. The manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms. On the outline, I say, the church is God's engine for revelation for the world. The verse talks about manifold wisdom. And there are those of you who are familiar with cars and engines and all that. I am not, but I do have sense enough to Google. And this is an intake manifold that's in everybody's car, in most cars, I guess. Maybe not in an electric car. Anyway, so the manifold is a contraption that is designed to take in fuel or take in some substance and then distribute it evenly among the various cylinders attached to the manifold. And there's another manifold function that's called exhaust manifold that gathers all the stuff that's been produced and makes sure that it is dispensed without killing the driver. And the church, see, what's missing in the world today is a manifold. And everything is getting in and not being released. Everything is choking everybody. All of our children are suffering and suffocating because of the absence of the manifold known as the church. So the church is busy trying to be like the culture. Next. Verse 11. No, again, verse 10. His intent was that now through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms. On the outline, I say, it doesn't say in heaven. It says in the heavenly realms. Doesn't say that the rulers and authorities in heaven need to know. It says the rulers and authorities in the kingdom, all earth, need to know. And it's the church that's got to inform them. Verse 11. According to his eternal purpose that he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. On the outline, I say, God isn't worried about how things are going to turn out. Why should we? God isn't worried about the war between Israel and Gaza, Israel and Hamas. God ain't worried about unrest in the Middle East. God ain't worried about how it's going to turn out with cruise ships and barges tearing down bridges in Baltimore. God ain't worried. So if God ain't worried, chill, like me and Sheila, on the beach in the Bahamas or Jamaica or somewhere. I don't have time to tell y'all a story about that, but anyway, that's a good lesson, isn't it? Come on, let's stand and give God glory in this house. Let's stand and give God glory in this house. I'll tell y'all that story one day. I almost had to beat Sheila down. Yeah, man. Yeah, that was awful. I think, John, didn't y'all go on that trip to, was it Jamaica? Was it Bahamas? One of them? Yeah. 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 Yep. Yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I thought I didn't have time to tell y'all this, but. I'm not going to do it. Do we have anybody in here who wants to become a member of our church tonight? Anybody here who wants to become a member of our church tonight? The teaching that I did tonight, if I must say so myself, is representative of the best kind of teaching that I do. If I must say so myself, it's representative of the best kind. So if you want to become a member of our church tonight, please come right now. Those of you who are watching by way of Facebook and YouTube, anybody who wants to belong here, we will take you in and we will love you into your destiny even when you fail, because ain't no love like olive love. Anybody here want to come and join, you can join now. Anybody there want to join, just type it in the comment section. If you don't want to join, do what you see on the screen. That's called worship. And if they reject you at your church for that, we'd be glad to have you. Amen. All right, lift those hands. I already made the announcements. We need your help. All right, come on, lift those hands and receive this. If you want to help, you can see Sheila and let her know you want to help. Receive this benediction. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the God who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ever ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power now and forever. Let us all say amen. Amen. I love you. I'll see you Friday night at the fashion show.
Hey, did you bless the oil down there?
I did not see it.